Today we're going to attempt to make a DIY color checker, but I'm going to be honest, I'm only doing this out of complete curiosity, and I'm extremely doubtful that it's even going to work. So on that note, let's get undone.
Gerald Undone. He's crazy.
What's happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and live from New York, it's Saturday night. My thinking for this video is that even if we completely fail to make a working DIY color checker, we still would have hopefully learned something about the X-Rite color checker and about working with color in our edits. So my first step was to bring my color checker passport video to Home Depot and grab any paint swatches that reasonably resemble the six primary color chips. Now I'm using exclusively paint swatches from Bear because they can be found at pretty much every Home Depot, but I'm also going to show you an online tool that you can use to match these color samples to other ones online that might be more available to you. Now, I don't have any B-roll of me picking out the colors at Home Depot, except for this little snippet that I grabbed on my phone for an Instagram story. But luckily, today's sponsor, Storyblocks, can hook us up with some stock footage so that I can accurately recreate the harrowing journey that was my Home Depot excursion. So I might have embellished my trip a little bit, and that's because I kept finding clips that I liked on Storyblocks, because it's actually a really great source for quality stock footage, as well as After Effects templates and some fun backgrounds and overlays. The interface is fantastic, and it's a subscription model with a reasonable yearly fee that gives you access to unlimited downloads, including 4K footage. And the clips are royalty-free for personal and commercial use, so you can use them as much as you want, wherever you want. So if you think you could take advantage of a fantastic library of quality footage and effects, check out Storyblocks using the link in the description below. So the next step was to take these swatches that have multiple colors on them and find the ones that more closely resemble the color chips and then cut them out into more workable sizes. And now we're going to use these to test which ones are the most accurate using a vectorscope. So first we need a control, and for this I'm using the Sony a7 III with the Sigma 35mm f1.4, and I'm using the Leeming LUT with its recommended settings for Cine 2. This combination is one that I found to be extremely color accurate, and as you can see here, will give nearly perfect results on the vectorscope. So in order to do this on the fly, I've got the vectorscope showing on the Ninja 5 here, which is seeing what the Sony's seeing, which is the X-Rite color checker passport video. And we can see that all of the primary color chips on the passport video are lining up extremely well with the boxes that correspond with each color around the outside edges of the vectorscope. And so now what we can do is we can take our swatches here from Home Depot and we can stick them in there and see if the line that's created falls very similarly to the line that was created by the X-Rite color checker, and then we'll know that our samples are at least relatively close to the chips on the X-Rite. I've also done a custom white balance on the Sony for this scene and dialed in my exposure, so now all we basically have to do is maintain that lighting, exposure, and white balance as we swap the paint swatches in and out. Alright, so I'm gonna move over here and start swapping in these swatches. I'll try and describe what I'm seeing, but the audio will probably be pretty bad. But just pay attention to the vectorscope up here on the Ninja, and you can see the line shift around and see if we can find one that basically gets hidden or replaces the X-Rite line. So let's start with the greens. So this one we can see is a bit more on the yellow side than the X-Rite one is. It's coming a little bit more yellow. Let's try a different one. This one has the same problem, maybe not as much yellow, but it's not quite as saturated as the chip that's provided there. And I've got one more here to try. And this is an example of one that's pretty bad. So it's not nearly as saturated, it's definitely more yellow, and it just doesn't have the same punch. Now this one, however, is actually doing pretty good. It follows the line pretty well. It may not be exactly as saturated, but there's also a glossy version on the other side that we could use that seems to get a little bit more of the saturation achieved, but this one's following the line nicely. So this one might be our best bet for the green color. Let's do one more example of doing the orangey-red chip, and then I'll just speed up the video when I do the rest of them. Okay, first try, that one's actually pretty good. It's lining up pretty well and the saturation is there as well. Maybe a little bit on the yellow side, but not too bad. I'll see if I have another one that's a little bit better. This one I would say has the same, this is very close, this color. I guess I would choose this one. It seems to be a bit better. Okay, so I've narrowed it down to the best six that I could find. So now let's put them together in the scene and see how they compare in concert against the X-Rite. Okay, so take a close look at the vectorscope here and try and slightly memorize the position of the lines and the dots and how they correspond to each other, and then I'm going to swap it out quickly with our swatches and see how well they perform. Okay, so we didn't do too badly. It's obviously not quite as good or as accurate as the X-Rite, and the vectorscope is kind of making this funky-looking spiderweb pattern now, which is actually kind of cool looking. But this isn't terrible, and actually I think that this warrants a further test. So now, let's use these for a more practical scenario where we'll actually try and correct a log image that doesn't already have, you know, the leaming LUT to correct it. And we'll see if we can get the color accurate using these on a log image, and then maybe compare it and see what would have happened if we would have used the leaming LUT, or if we would have used the X-Rite chart. Now, like I said, I got all of these from Home Depot, and I'll put the color codes for these in the description below, but I'm also going to put a link to this tool from Easy RGB, where you can actually put in the color code from a paint swatch. So for instance, I'll take this yellow one here, and it's called P330-5M Midori. So if we type that in here, Midori, we can see P330-5M Bare Color Collection. That's what this one is. Now, if we click on it, and we can choose all collections, but you can narrow that down if you have a specific collection that you're looking for. We'll just click compare, and it'll show us a bunch of different brands here, as well as the formulations and the name of the color code. So if you find something here from, you know, California or Ace Clark, or there was a, you know, Benjamin Moore, there's Deluxe. If you find something in there that will match something that you have better access to than these Home Depot colors, then you can go and pick up the swatches from your store, whatever's more convenient. Or you can even use these to generate an online web color if you want it as well. So I'll put a link to this tool in the description so that you can match the colors to best serve your purpose. Okay, so I've got the clips opened up here in Resolve, and I'll just walk you through how you can correct using this, and we'll see what the results are like. So this first shot is the one where it's just me, I put my arm in here into this shot, and we've got a few different colorful things spread out, and here's our little color checker lined up here. So we're gonna move over to the color panel, and I'll show you what you do if you want to correct something using curves. So we're going to switch over to the color curves here. This is hue versus hue. This is where we can start. And we have our vectorscope on the side here. Now, this was shot using some light that isn't ideal, usually causes some colors to be weird. So we're going to try and fix those to make them line up on the vectorscope and then see if we get a decent result or if things go weird, like the Rubik's Cube changes or the skin no longer looks like skin, that kind of thing. So first, as we can see, the vectorscope is kind of a mess right now. That's because we're picking up all kinds of different colors. So the easiest way to do this probably is just to zoom in. We can just activate the transform controls here, and I'll put this probably to, let's set it to like 2.8. That's just going to scale it into 2.8 and pretty much just our colors and not be confused by anything else. So I'm going to move everything else out of the shot so that we don't have the skin or anything. We just have our colors here. Now when we switch over to the color panel, our vectorscope is a little bit simpler, and it's making that weird spiderweb pattern that we saw on the Ninja 5. You see there's these lines running along here, so we can go ahead and put points on those lines. And that will pretty much set us up. And we also need to put one right at the boundary here. So if we raise it up, we can see that it moves more towards red. And if we bring it down, it moves more towards yellow. So let's raise it up until it lines up with the red. And the reason why you want to do this with curves is that you get a smoother transition rather than just a spike. Now let's move over to the magenta point, which is actually kind of hard to see because it's just this little one right here. The magenta doesn't seem to have a lot of saturation, but we'll deal with that in a second. So just get it kind of lined up to magenta. And then we'll keep moving our way down. So blue's pretty good. We'll put that there. The cyan one, we'll try to line it up, and then green, same idea, and then yellow finally, we'll put that in position. Now we need to deal with the saturation because these aren't evenly saturated, but I think this is where we're going to run into problems with our DIY chart. So move over to the hue versus saturation, same idea, let's put points on all of these. Now, if we wanted to make the saturation relatively even between them and say that we wanted to use how far the red is as the base one, then we just need to increase the saturation of others and maybe bring the blue down. So let's start with the magenta because it's the one that has the least saturation. So we're going to jack that way up here. And then we'll bring the yellow down a little bit. The green can stay probably where it is. The cyan needs a bit more. And the blue needs to be toned down. So now, I think the magenta still needs a bit more. Basically, we're just trying to make it relatively even. I would say that the green could maybe use a little bit of a boost, and then the cyan a bit more of a boost. So what we're going to do is we're going to go back to the edit, and we're going to unzoom. But first, if you want to just turn it off and on, because that's what it looked like before, and that's what it looked like after. I feel like we're getting a bit too much of a rosy hue here. So let's go back to the edit page, and we will unzoom our image. Let's put it back. And yeah, so you know what, it's not terrible, but definitely the something in this, I think it might have been the magenta that was causing the problems. We definitely have too much magenta in our reds. Our reds are very, very rosy. We have a pink, sort of a pink thing going on everywhere. And it was the same thing that I noticed when I went through all the swatches in that rapid time, was that the magenta swatch is very difficult to match. I went through pretty much every one at the store, and I couldn't find one that was saturated enough, but also, I guess, like, neutrally magenta. They all seem to have, maybe that's because people don't want to paint their walls that color, but I had a really hard time matching that. And so while I wouldn't say that this is terrible, it's not great. Now let's switch over and see what happens if we would have just put the Leaming LUT on it, which corrects all the colors for us, and we can see what the Leaming LUT intended image result would be. So that is this one here, and as we can see, there's no correction done. If we look at our curves here, they're all exactly neutral, but all of our points are pretty much perfectly lined up on the vectorscope. And now let's take a look at what that image looks like zoomed out. It looks like this, a little bit contrastier, but the Leaming LUT gives you more of a finished image. So just based on looking at this, I think I'm gonna add a little bit more contrast and take away a little bit of saturation, just overall saturation from a paint swatch version, and then see how it compares in a side-by-side to the Leaming LUT version. So the main difference that I notice is that the Leaming LUT has much better reds. The reds over on our paint swatch version are much more contaminated with pink, where the Leaming LUT has the appropriate amount of orange in there, and I think that's gonna create a better skin tone overall than ours, which looks a little bit rosy here. So overall, not bad. It's much better than I thought it was gonna be, but in practice, I think you're still better off getting one of these passport color checker things, because when it comes to getting accurate color, it doesn't really make sense to go through the trouble of making a tool that only gets you somewhat accurate color. You probably should pursue actual accurate color if that's your goal. And plus this, you know, this comes with some other things. It's got like a hard outside case, it's rugged, it fits in your pocket well. It's got other tools like the exposure bars. And on this side, you've got the white balance card as well as a focus checker. So it's a handy little tool, and it will actually get you accurate color instead of sort of accurate color. But knowing which paint colors are similar to the X-Rite will allow you to do something that you can't do with the color checker, which is to paint your wall to look like a color checker, which would be a pretty cool idea for a studio. But anyway, this was a fun experiment, and I thank you for coming along for the ride. But that's gonna be it for me. I hope you found this video helpful, or at least entertaining. And if you did, make sure you leave it the old thumbs up and consider subscribing if you haven't already. But if you did not find this video helpful or entertaining, feel free to hit the dislike button twice. All right, I'm done.